worship. Even if you're online, you can check in. And I think Parker's pushing play.
I'm hurting and broken within, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin. Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was borrowed. Precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior is indeed wonderful. Sing hallelujah.
Central Baptist Church. I know that we got a little bit of a late start, but nonetheless, God is good and is great to be with you. I wanted to bring a couple of things that we're going to be doing. First off, this coming Wednesday night, we're going to set up various what they call stations of the cross. And it is just different elements that will be there that we'll be able to pray over and see and there's be kind of guided through. And it will end at the cross, and there will be a chance for you by yourself or with your family to partake in the Lord's Supper. All right. And so we are excited for you to be a part of that. This will be kind of a change from our normal Wednesday night prayer meeting that we've been having, but it will be a sweet time. So We're asking everybody to come in through the back entrance there that leads us into the fellowship hall, and we'll congregate there, get started, then we're going to go in kind of intervals, you know, so that families can be separate, and it can be a time for y'all to linger a little bit, and it will be just a sweet time, I'm sure. I hope that everybody can be a part of that. If you are able, and even folks tuning in online, it would be great for y'all to come and partake in that particular event as well. We also have something happening on Thursday night. This is kind of late notice on this, but something we just kind of found out about, that the International Mission Board is hosting a digital conference. It's a two-hour conference. They're going to be sharing some of their insights and hopes for the future of missions, and how churches of any size and any flavor can get involved with that. And so it's going to be from 6 to 8. It'll be a live stream that we tune into. There will be various speakers, but it will all be hosted by the Southern Baptist Convention's International Mission Board. There will be no fee or anything like that. If you're interested, we'll meet here in the sanctuary and watch it and partake in that. So if you have any question about that, let me know. But that'll be this Thursday night from 6 to 8 p.m. And I think they're going to run a pretty tight schedule on that. So we'll get started right at 6 with those things. Hope that you can come. The next thing that I wanted to mention to you is Thanksgiving is coming up, and we've traditionally done a kind of a Thanksgiving banquet feast, if you will, where we do it potluck style, and so we're hoping to do that again this coming Thanksgiving. Now, there's been a little bit of talk about, do we do it the Sunday of Thanksgiving week, you know, kind of gearing up, that would be exciting, or should we maybe do it the week before, because, you know, then if folks are traveling or whatever it might be, that might be a better week. Okay. And so I thought it'd be fun where, instead of just talking about it, we'll just decide. So this is not an official business meeting, but I'm going to take a vote this morning. So we have two options on the table here. Only here in the room or present can vote, and we'll decide it for everybody else who's not here. Okay. Sorry for anybody else that is outside of the room. Oh, Steve just walked in, so he's going to get his vote for sure. Would you prefer to have it on the 15th, November the 15th, a couple of weeks before Thanksgiving to kind of give that buffer and all those things? Or would you prefer to have it on the 22nd, right before Thanksgiving week, ready to go, get the turkey, and just be excited? All right. So all in favor of the 15th, raise your hands. Oh, okay. Good deal. Right, I'm not counting those because it's most everybody. Anybody in favor of the 22nd? I don't see any votes right there. So boom, it passes. So friends, look forward to a Thanksgiving potluck celebration on the 15th. Should be a lot of fun. Now, what we'll do in conjunction with that is have our final business meeting of the year, right, like during the dessert time, as we do. And so if you've got any questions or any input towards the church budget, this is when we present that for the next calendar year. And so get with anybody in the stewardship committee, Miss Felicia, Miss Michelle Shulak, and Jennifer Zent, Steve Sawyer. Those are our stewardship committee. Talk with them about that. And if you have any questions about what we can do with the Lord's blessing, we'll be excited to entertain those and bring them to the vote. And so that'll be the purpose of that business meeting during that Thanksgiving celebration. All right. Does that all make sense? Good. Looking forward to celebrating with you guys. Let's spend just a quick moment in prayer and then continue singing to our great sovereign Lord. Heavenly Father, I ask, Lord, that you would help us to tune our hearts to you this morning. I pray, Lord, that each of us would be excited about what you're doing and how you're leading and where you're taking us. Lord, your kingdom is alive and vibrant in the hearts of your church here at Central Baptist. Lord, may we be that city on a hill, the light to the community here in Itasca and to the ends of the earth, to get them excited and on fire for you as well. Lord, may it start with the words that we speak today, that they would be a blessing and an encouragement to your heart in your throne room. May we love you with all that we are. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray these things. Amen. Now, friends, let me ask you to stand again for this next song where we sing of how great a sovereign God we serve.
Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, with me in the calm, with me in the storm. Sovereign in my greatest joy, sovereign in my deepest cry, with me in the dark, with me at the dawn. In your everlasting arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never failing love, you work everything for good. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, deepest cry, with me in the dark, with me at the dawn. In your everlasting arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never failing love, you work everything.
Just a second.
I apologize. Okay.
We're in Psalm 135. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise him, you who serve the Lord. You who serve in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Celebrate his lovely name with music. For the Lord has chosen Jacob for himself, Israel for his own special treasure. I know the greatness of the Lord, that our Lord is greater than any other God. The Lord does whatever pleases him. Throughout all heaven and earth and on the seas and in their depths, he causes the clouds to rise over the whole earth. He sends the lightning with the rain and releases the wind from his storehouses. He destroys the firstborn in each Egyptian home, both people and animals. He performed miraculous signs and wonders in Egypt against Pharaoh and all his people. He struck down great nations and slaughtered mighty kings. Sihon, king of the Amorites, Og, king of Bashan, and all the kings of Canaan. He gave their land as an inheritance, a special possession to his people Israel. Your name, O Lord, endures forever. Your fame, O Lord, is known to every generation. For the Lord will give justice to his people and have compassion on his servants. The idols of the nations are merely things of silver and gold, shaped by human hands. They have mouths but cannot speak, and their eyes cannot see. They have ears but cannot hear, and mouths but cannot breathe. And those who make idols are just like them, as are all who trust in them. O Israel, praise the Lord. O priests, descendants of Aaron, praise the Lord. O Levites, praise the Lord. All you who hear the Lord, praise the Lord. The Lord be praised from Zion, for he lives here in Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
As we praise the Lord, we remember that he's called us to bring hope to those that are lost, to bring the truth of the gospel. We're going to sing now, "Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior." And as we're singing that, let that be a prayer from your heart to him, that you would be reminded that he has called us to love him and to love those that he loves. Let's sing together.
Oh,
we ask that you would give us a heart, Lord, that would not just sing a song like that with a personal bent, because it sounds so great for how we feel and how we yearn for you. But I pray, Lord, that you would help us to realize that we are not the only ones who sing that song, and that there are millions and millions and scores of people, even in our community, who are singing that song, needing you as a Savior. Lord, may we be your help, be your hands and feet as we go, so that none of them feel passed by, but that where you would speak a word, may we be bold enough to say it. Where you would lead us, we would stand and show love and grace and mercy, the same that you have shown us. Lord, we pray for the gifts that you give us, the blessing through finance and time and skill that you pour out on us. Lord, as we give those back to the church through tithes and offerings, may they be used for your glory. May they be used for your kingdom's sake. For those who are in charge of dispersing it, give them wisdom about where it should go. For us as a body, for as we pray about and think about where do we need to head and what kind of ministries do we need to be involved in, may we have that wisdom. May we have the boldness to walk in it as well. I pray that what we give would be used for your glory and your glory alone, that many would come to know that you are their Savior and you have not passed them by. We ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Please have a seat.
I'll remind you that our offerings are being collected at the back. We've got that lovely treasure chest now, and we'd love for you to drop them in as you either come into the service or head out this morning if the Lord would lead. There's also ways that you can give via online or through the mail and all those things. We are thankful for the way that you as a church continue to serve God and bless us. And this morning is the last Sunday of the month, and we from time to time try to do something geared for the kiddos. And so I wanted to speak to you guys for just a moment, the kiddos that are in the room and any that maybe are tuning in online. I know that a few of them watch with their parents, and we're grateful that they do. In a couple of weeks, something big's going to happen in our country. There's going to be an election, right? And no doubt you guys have heard about that. You've probably talked about it with your parents or grandparents, or maybe even at school, your teachers have brought that up. I can remember when I was a little kid, we would do kind of those pretend votes where we would elect, you know, whoever the president was going to be. Not that our vote counted back then, but teachers did that with me, and maybe they're doing that with you as well. You've probably heard a lot of people talk, and it sounds, maybe you even watched some of these debates that have been on, and you've seen this, and you wonder yourself, why are those two guys so mean to each other? It's a good question. I ask the same thing myself. There's a lot of people, it seems like, that are going to be very sad and upset in the next couple of weeks because they're so passionately supporting one person or the other, and only one of them can win. In just a couple of Tuesdays, we're going to have an election, and then we'll have a winner, and that person will be our next president. And it feels like the way that things are going, there's going to be a lot of people upset one way or another because they both can't win. I hear, and I've heard a lot my whole life, people have said, oh, these elections, this one right here we're having, it's the most important one we've ever had. And, you know, it's always the most important one we've ever had because it's the one we're having right now. That they've all been big and they've all been pivotal and, you know, things could change and all of this. I was thinking about that this week and wondering, how best can I maybe encourage you kiddos in the midst of this? Friends, in a couple of Tuesdays will be the official election. Maybe your parents have already cast their vote. Your grandparents, your family members have already done theirs. But the official vote will happen here on November the 3rd, and then on the 4th we'll have a winner, maybe. That depends on how long it takes to count all the votes, but we can get into that later. But one person will be our next president. But let me remind you that it doesn't matter who our president is, because America will still continue to go on whoever's leading, okay? It'll still be America, and you will still get to go to school, and you'll still get to do all the things that you love and all that. But more importantly, our lives don't depend on who the president is or who the mayor is or the governor or any of those things. We live to serve the king. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There's a man that was a pastor for about almost 50 years in California. His name is S.M. Lockridge. His actual name is Shadrach Meshach Lockridge. That's his name. And back in the 70s, he got a little bit of notoriety because he preached a famous sermon called Amen. And it only lasted about 6 minutes. It was a pretty powerful message. And I've got a video of it here that I'd like for you to see, that you can be reminded that no matter who's in the White House or what important election we're having, how your parents feel or how the neighbors feel or your teacher says this or that or whatever it is, that we know who is really in charge, who really is the King of Kings. I've got it prepared for us, I believe. Hopefully we can push play and we can watch it together. And as we listen to it together, let's be reminded of who we actually can serve and who really is in charge. Will you watch it with me?
The Bible says my king is the king of the Jews. He's a king of Israel. He's a king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know him? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's the centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient Savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. The sick, he cleanses the lepers, he forgives sinners, he discharges debtors, he delivers the captive, he defends the feeble, he blesses the young, he serves the unfortunate, he rewards the aged, he rewards the diligent, and he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's a key to knowledge, he's a wellspring of wisdom, he's a doorway of deliverance, he's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is lighter. I wish I could describe it.
Shadrach, Meshach, Lockridge preached that sermon back in 1970. And you know what was happening back in 1970? There was a president that we had that got himself into trouble, and everybody was really upset about it, and he resigned and said, I can't be president anymore. Friends, it doesn't matter who is in charge of this country, because we know who is in charge of our life. We lean on God. We lean on His righteousness, Jesus. You can't live without Him. May we put our hope in Him. Friends, we don't have to be afraid on November 4th what the country's going to say, because we know that God is in control and that Jesus will always be the King. Death couldn't hold Him. The grave couldn't keep Him. And He takes away the sins. And that is better than any president that we've ever had, going all the way back to George Washington. Friends, let's be thankful that God has given us a King of Kings. Let's pray about that together. Heavenly Father, Lord, let our hearts be settled on You. Let our joy be made complete in who You are. Lord, for what comes in the future, we do not know, but we know that You'll be with us. We know that no matter what, You will always be on Your throne. Changes will happen, seasons will come and go, birthdays will be forgotten, but You will remain. Lord, I pray that all of my friends here would find hope in You, and in the fear that can come with the uncertainty of life, may they lean on Your understanding, and they would find their joy, they would find their rest in Your sweet embrace. We pray all of these things in the name of Your Son, Jesus, through the power of Your Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, friends, let me invite you then, all of us, kiddos and adults, to turn to Numbers chapter 17. That's where we're going to spend a little bit of our time. We're also going to look at chapter 18 as well. Last week, we ended off on what I called a little bit of a cliffhanger. You know, I'm not much of a storyteller, so I don't know how much of a cliffhanger it was, but nonetheless, we kind of stopped in the middle of the story, if you will. Remember what happened. Korah decided that he might know what's best, and he got a bunch of his friends to jump in and try to rebel against Moses and Aaron. And as he rebelled, he came up against really what God was doing. And God didn't really appreciate that, because God's on His throne and nobody else can be on His throne. He puts people where they need to be. And so, because they rebelled and because they wanted to stand in their rebellion and did not want to change, did not repent, they were swallowed up in the earth. Remember we read about that, where everybody got swallowed up and then like the ground opened and then it closed over, they were gone. And then not only that, the next day, the very next day, the rest of the congregation, the rest of Israel was like, hey, all those people are dead. Why? You know, and they're mad too. And they're getting all upset. And, you know, God sent a plague to the people of Israel. And do you remember what happened? Even though Moses and even though Aaron were being picked on and accused wrongly, they were humble and faithful to God. And so they jumped right into action. Remember we read that great verse right there towards the end of verse 16, where Aaron is going and putting the holy fire amongst the camp. And it says that he stood between the living and the dead. Right? That he was there to prevent that, to try to stand in the way of that punishment that was coming. And God relented of that plague, and many actually were saved. We stopped ourselves right there. Friends, as we pick up with that story, I want us to remember this, that God gifts us a mediator so that we might approach his throne without fear. God gifts us a mediator so that we might approach his throne without fear. A mediator is someone who stands in between and works between one party and the other to try to find some sort of conclusion or reconciliation or agreement. And God has always given us folks to do that. He gave the priests to interact. Moses was there to lead his people out and to give them the commandments. And then the priests were set up, and then all the way down to Christ. We'll get into that in just a minute. But God gifts us a mediator so that we might approach his throne without fear. Let's pick up the rest of the story starting in chapter 17, verse 1. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to the people of Israel and get from them staffs, one for each father's house from all their chiefs according to their father's houses, 12 staffs. Write each man's name on his staff and write Aaron's name on the staff of Levi, for there shall be one staff for the head of each father's house. And then you shall deposit them in the tent of meeting before the testimony where I meet with you. And the staff of the man whom I choose shall sprout. Thus I will make to cease from me the grumblings of the people of Israel, which they grumble against you." God is saying here, friends, that he wants to put a stop to all this grumbling and show who the true leader should be, who the true mediator should be. Picking up in verse 6, Moses spoke to the people of Israel and all their chiefs, and all the chiefs gave him staffs, one for each chief, according to their father's houses, 12 staffs, and the staff of Aaron was among their staffs. And Moses deposited the staffs before the Lord in the tent of testimony. So 12 staffs put there in the tent of meeting, ready for God to show his favor. Verse 8, on the next day, Moses went into the tent of testimony, and behold, the staff of Aaron for the house of Levi had sprouted and put forth buds and produced blossoms, and it bore ripe almonds. And Moses brought out all the staffs from before the Lord to all the people of Israel, and they looked, and each man took his staff. And the Lord said to Moses, "Put back the staff of Aaron before the testimony, to be kept as a sign for the rebels, that you may make an end of their grumblings against me, lest they die." Thus did Moses as the Lord commanded him. So he did. And the people of Israel said to Moses, "Behold, we perish, we are undone, we are all undone. Everyone who comes near to the tabernacle of the Lord shall die. Are we all to perish?" Friends, I'm sure some of you, maybe even in your own yard or at your own house, have seen branches broken off of trees or limbs cut loose and maybe just down to the trunk, only to see that tree sprout new shoots and new life and it grow there. And that's understandable because the roots are still hooked into the ground, right? They're still getting their nutrients, and we see that. You see it in trees all the time. But here we have dead wood that has been cut and shaped in the form of staffs to fit the size of the person using it or whatever, and it has been dead for quite some time, that wood, but God was able to make it branch and grow. He gave life to that staff of Aaron to show so that there was no doubt who his choice for mediator was. Once and for all, a sign to say, these are the ones, Aaron and his line, Levi and his line, they shall be my attendants, they shall be my servants in the temple, in the tabernacle, to mediate between me and you. And why, in fact, do we need a mediator? We see it there at the end of this passage, verse 13, 12 and 13, where they say, "We perish." Verse 13 says, "If we come near to the tabernacle of the Lord, we shall die. Are we all to perish?" Remember what we've talked about here, that a holy God cannot abide by sin. Sin cannot be present in the holy God. That's why they were thrown out of the garden when they did sin. Because if they sinned and then lived forever, ate from the tree of life, they would forever be cut off from God.
And so death was actually a blessing to them. And here they're talking about we're going to perish because of God. We, because of our sin with God, and we need to make that right. They recognize it in themselves. And that rod was placed there at the tent of meeting so that anybody could look in and see that it was there in the testimony and know that God set it as a sign, as a barrier and a buffer for them. Friends, that's what the mediator is, to be able to bridge that gap. Now, God put into place the priesthood and all of those folks, the Levites, to serve, to be that mediation on their behalf. And that's really what chapter 18 gets into, talking about all those different things. And so what I wanted us to see here is in this passage, in all of chapter 18, we see how what God gives as mediation is a gift of protection from us, for us, I should say. A gift of protection. A gift, I say, in that it's not something that we earned. We didn't turn in enough coupons to get it. We didn't save enough to buy it. We didn't earn it through our hard toil and labor. It was given freely to us because God loves and because He's benevolent and full of mercy and abounding in grace. Right? And so it is a gift and it is a protection for us that we might be free from the burden and penalty and guilt of sin. Let me get into it right here. Point one, to kind of prove what we're talking about here. The priesthood was a gift of protection against destruction through perversion. Look at these first couple of verses of chapter 18 with me. It says, "So the Lord said to Aaron, you and your sons and your father's house with you shall bear iniquity connected with the sanctuary, and you and your sons with you shall bear iniquity connected with your priesthood. And with you bring your brothers also, the tribe of Levi, the tribe of your father, that they may join you and minister to you while you and your sons are with you before the tent of testimony." Notice what it says there in the first part, that they shall bear the iniquity connected with the sanctuary. That they're the ones that are bearing the weight of sin on the people of Israel's behalf. They have sinned, the people have sinned, a perversion of God's justice, a perversion of God's law, and they all bear the guilt of that. But the guilt can be brought to the temple, and they're placed on the throne, placed on the altar, I should say. Not the throne, the altar. And on the altar, a sacrifice could be made, right? What did they recognize in their hearts? That we're going to perish. Something has to die so that you might live. That has been, do you remember back into the garden? Remember those stories? What did God give them? Did He make a clothing of linen? Did He get together the wool and make them a garment? Did He sew together those leaves and make those things? No, He provided animal skins that they would wear. Something had to die so that their sin might be covered. That is found throughout all of Scripture. Something has to die so that we might live. There is a penalty when it comes to sin. And yes, friends, arrogance and pride are just as sinful as murder. Lustful thoughts are just as sinful as the actual sexual immorality that you might commit. That all of them. Now, of course, they have different ways that they play out, right? If I murder you, you will be dead, and that is a big thing. But if I am prideful and arrogant, it's almost like I'm killing myself, and I'm allowing you to die because I could care less what happens to you. Because it doesn't matter what's going on in your life, because I'm only prideful in myself. Do you see how that plays out? Obviously, there's different repercussions in the way that it goes out into the world. But as we stand before God, the serial killer will be just as guilty and just as broken and just as worthy earning death as the serial liar. Right? Even though the outward appearances don't seem to be as strong. Friends, any sin bears the weight of iniquity upon us. And that weight of iniquity is meant to go. It is, any sin is a perversion. And so the priesthood was given as a gift of protection so that we might not be destroyed through perversion, through sin. That the priesthood is the mediator there, here in the nation of Israel. The mediator there to provide that protection. Secondly, we see here that the Levites were a gift of protection against destruction through plunder. The Levites were a gift of protection against destruction through plunder. Let's look at verse 3 together. Verse 3 says, "They shall keep guard over you and over the whole tent, but shall not come near the vessels of the sanctuary to the altar, lest they and you die. They shall join you and keep guard over the tent of meeting for all the service of the tent, and no outsider shall come near you. You shall keep guard over the sanctuary and over the altar, that there may never again be wrath on the people of Israel. And behold, I have taken your brothers, the Levites, from among the people of Israel. They are a gift to you, given to the Lord, to do the service of the tent of meeting. And you and your sons with you shall guard the priesthood for all that concerns the altar that is within the veil, and you shall serve. I give your priesthood as a gift, and I, and any outsider who comes near shall be put to death." Literally, the Levites were there to guard, to be a barrier or a hedge for the temple, for the tabernacle, for the priesthood that was serving. They were literally to stand watch and attend in any way that they needed. But also to protect, because plunder, when we talk about that, I mean, and over Israel's history, there were lots of people. I mean, Solomon's temple itself was one of the great wonders of the world that had renown all over the known universe, if you will. And people came far and wide, and they wanted to pillage it, and it came under destruction at a couple of different times where it was robbed and these kinds of things. But also, too, not just that physical outside trying to steal, but also, too, those folks that would try to approach the temple or the tabernacle and try to take what wasn't theirs. This gift of, like, they could do it wrong, right? They could show up and say, "Well, God's going to forgive me because I'm doing it the way, because I want it, because I demand it. Because I earned it, because I'm an Israelite, because I'm the son of this or the son of that," or whatever it is. And the Levites were there to help teach and remind and show people, no, that's not what it is. I mean, it everything from physically guarding to spiritually maintaining the truth of how this gift of reconciliation and forgiveness is given out. That was their job. It is no small task that they're meant to do. But they were a gift of protection for the nation of Israel so that they would not come to destruction through plunder. People trying to take what wasn't theirs, what wasn't rightfully theirs. Because forgiveness itself has to be given by God. It cannot be earned. It cannot be captured. It is a gift that they must receive. Thirdly, the offerings were a gift of protection against destruction through poverty. The offerings were a gift of protection against destruction through poverty. Look with me at verse 8. "Then the Lord spoke to Aaron, 'Behold, I have given you charge of the contributions made to me, all the consecrated things of the people of Israel. I have given them to you as a portion and to your sons as a perpetual due. This shall be yours in the most of the most holy things reserved from the fire, every offering of theirs, every grain offering of theirs, every sin offering of theirs, and every guilt offering of theirs, which they render to me, shall be most holy to you and to your sons. In the most holy place shall you eat it. Every male may eat it. It is holy to you. This also is yours, the contribution of their gift, all the wave offering of the people. I have given them to you and to your sons and daughters with you as a perpetual due. Everyone who is clean in your house may eat it, all the best of the oil and all the best of the wine and of the grain of the first fruits of what they give to the Lord, I give to you." Skip down with me to verse 20. It says, and the Lord said to Aaron, you shall have no inheritance in their land, neither shall you have any portion among them. I am your portion and your inheritance among the people of Israel. Friends, the offerings that were given were a protection against destruction through poverty. Friends, I think that there is, especially in this day and age, but really, honestly, it doesn't matter which day and age, when you struggle with poverty, physical poverty, where you don't know where your next meal is going to come from, or when the bill is due and all those things, and you don't know how you're going to make ends meet, that is one of the things that will send you into a destructive state where all you can focus is on that and not see anything else. Aaron and his priesthood, the Levites themselves, were not going to be able to have land in the promised land. They were not going to be able to homestead. They were not going to be able to live on it and pass on through their generations. They were going to live on the portion of God. They were going to have homes, and they were going to be able to do those things, but it was all going to be at the grace of what God gave them. And so God prepared a way for them to be taken care of so that they don't have to suffer through where am I going to eat and what am I going to do and how am I going to feed my family, that these gifts, that some of them were consumed all the way up through fire and as an offering to God, but some of them were set aside. And he gives specific rules. He speaks to it in some of those later verses. He talks about it in depth in the book of Leviticus. But here he reminds the folks, as we're talking about here in Numbers, about what it is that he's protecting them against, that he will be their portion and he will be their protection against destruction from poverty. Fourthly, look with me at verse 21, the tithes were a gift of protection against destruction through pride. Destruction through pride. Verse 21 picks up, to the Levites, I have given them every tithe in Israel for an inheritance in return for their service that they do, their service in the tent of meeting. Now, let me stop there just for a minute, because I want to make sure that we're saying this correctly. Aaron and his line shall be the royal priesthood. Okay? And they will serve as the priests. The Levites are not serving as priests. They are serving the priests in what they do. Now, Aaron and Levi are all kind of jumbled up, if you will, from the tribe of Levi and all that. But Aaron and his line are the ones, that's where the priesthood passes down. The Levites themselves are a separate entity. They don't become priests. They always serve as Levites. Does that make sense? You with me on there? I just want to make sure that we're covering that. Let's talk about that, the service that they're doing. Pick up in verse 22. They do this service so that the people of Israel do not come near the tent of the meeting, lest they bear sin and die. But the Levites shall do the service of the tent of meeting, and they shall bear their iniquity. It shall be a perpetual statute throughout your generations. And among the people of Israel, they shall have no inheritance. They're in this same boat that the priests are in, that they don't have any inheritance either. And so, of the tithes that are giving, that are required of the people of Israel, that is what is set aside to cover their service, to make sure that they are taken care of. The offerings themselves are what go to the priests, but the tithe is something separate from the offering, and it goes to the Levites, where they would have that. It's something that they use to, since they don't have land to homestead or anything like that, they have the tithe that is given. Let's skip down to verse 25 real quickly. It says, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, moreover, you shall speak and say to the Levites, when you take from the people of Israel the tithe that I have given you from them for your inheritance, then you shall present a contribution from it to the Lord, a tithe of the tithe. And your contribution shall be counted to you as though it were the grain of the threshing floor and as the fullness of the winepress, so that you also present a contribution to the Lord from all your tithes which you receive from the people of Israel, and from it you shall give to the Lord's contribution to Aaron and the priests. Out of all the gifts to you, you shall present every contribution due to the Lord. from each its best part to be dedicated. Therefore you shall say to them, when you have offered it from the best of it, then the rest shall be counted to the Levites as produce to the threshing floor and as produce of the winepress. Let's stop there, and because they continue, the verses continue on talking about how they're meant to eat it and consume it. And then it says here, verse 32 at the very end, it says, "You shall not profane the holy things of the people of Israel, lest you die, lest you die." The tithe was commanded of the people to give 10% of what they earned and what they produce and given to the temple for its use. And the tithe was first given to the Levites to be able to use and take care of their families and provide in those ways. But even the Levites themselves were to take a tenth of theirs and give it to the priests. So the priests didn't just live on the offerings, the sacrifices, they also lived on a tenth of the tenth. And, listen, God is letting them earn this, right? That they're receiving it. It's just as if they had done it at the wine press. It's just as they had been working at the threshing floor. But instead, they get to count it. They didn't do the work, but they get to count it. Friends, God is reminding them that He is taking care of them. He is watching over them, and that there's a gift of protection here against destruction through pride. That they know that whatever is happening, however, whatever life that they are able to afford, it's only because of God's grace. Now, friends, you might be asking, well, this is great, and that's a wonderful history lesson, Pastor. I really appreciate you talking and breaking that down, and I'm glad that the Levites did that. And, hopefully they'll all live correctly, and we won't have any more trouble for the rest of the book, right? We could probably just stop right here. Well, I got bad news for you. They actually don't live very well after this, and there's more trouble that comes, and we'll get into those in coming months. But more importantly, just talking about this today, what does this mean for us? What does this mean for you and me reading it today? How are we to receive this? Because number one, we're not Levites. And number two, there's no tabernacle. And number three, there's no priesthood that is offering sacrifice. So what does it mean to me? The book of Hebrews talks about how the priesthood and the Levites, the service of the temple, went on day and night. And that's what it took to keep the iniquity of sin away. But that Jesus came and once and for all wiped all of that out. Something has to die so that you might live. That's been the measure. God gives us the command to be holy. He requires perfection. He asked of it of Adam and Eve. He asks it of you and me. When we fall short of that, in which we do, because we all pervert the law of God, the commands of God, His grace and goodness, then we bear the burden of iniquity. And we need that mediator just as much as they needed it back then. We look at this and we see how there is a destruction that comes through perversion. Through sin, we think about the sin in our lives and the way that it destroys us. I don't care if it is murder or it is arrogance. All of it is the same, and anyone will bring any amount of it will bring you to destruction. And we don't look to some priesthood, some great fun guys that know the Bible and know the truth, and somehow they're going to make it better. We look to the King of Kings, who was able with one fell swoop, with one word, wipe out all of our penalty. He's the one, Christ. Not just Christ on the cross, not just Christ in the tomb, but Christ at the right hand of God, who has left death and sin and shame in the grave. Friends, He is our royal priest, our high priest, that His work cannot be undone. And that He gives us a gift of protection against destruction through perversion. Secondly, we see this gift of protection that was given as a destruction through plunder. A reminder for us that as we interact and work and are a, what does the Bible say about the church, right? That we need to encourage one another and help one another. We act as a hedge, if you will, protection for each other to do right by God and to live for Him so that we don't try to gain what isn't ours. We think that we've somehow accomplished everything. We've built this building with our blood, sweat, and tears, and so we have it. We're in charge. Everything that has been given to us is a grace of the Almighty, and we try to claim it as our own. Friends, I'm thankful for the faithful men and women who have come for 114 years or some odd, have been part of Central Baptist Church, and have done well, and has passed it faithfully on from generation to generation. But if we're thankful for our forefathers or we're thankful for our own hard work, then we are stealing from God and His glory. God is the one who has carried us through and sustained us all these ways. This church is a testament to what He is able to do with broken and bruised and battered believers. When we try to plunder it all the time with our own self-righteousness, our own value, friends, together we are meant to remind us not to approach that, to see that budded staff, to be a reminder that we can't do it on our own. We think about this protection against destruction through poverty. The poverty of life is for sure a deterrent, and we're thankful for God and the way He provides. But even what did Jesus say? Foxes have holes to live in. The lilies of the field have clothing that cannot be matched. The birds have food wherever they go, but the Son of Man doesn't have anywhere to lay His head. I know I'm mixing a lot of verses there all at once, but you get the picture. Even Jesus Himself wasn't worried about building a bank account or a 401k, stocking up His garage or His bunker with all kinds of provisions just in case. He was ready to be willing and able to live on what God was giving him and what God was providing. There is no get-rich scheme or hard, diligent work that we can achieve that is going to somehow make it all okay. Because what do we see? The rich sometimes get richer and sometimes they get poorer. And the poor sometimes get rich and sometimes they stay poor. And there's no rhyme or reason or anything. It just happens because it's life. One wrong decision, one bad choice, one lucky encounter, whatever it might be. Oh, friends, we presume too much to think that somehow success and security, safety, is just a blessing of God. When we know for a fact that the blessing of God is the blessing of God, no matter how much food is in our tummy or clothes are on our back or any of those things. But worse still is the poverty of spirit that we endure. Because when we seek after the riches of this world, when we think that we've got security and safety and we've built up this nest egg to be able to provide for the rest of our lives, we are poor in spirit because we presume on our own ability, and we forget that we need God and His blessing and His ability to carry us through. The poverty of empty tummies and low bank accounts is nothing compared to the poverty of our own spirits being destroyed because we're counting on ourselves. Lastly, the tithes are a gift of protection against destruction through pride. Oh, how easy it is for us to be destroyed by pride, to say that we've earned this. And it's just like these Levites who said, hey, it's just as if you were able to be at the wine press or be at the threshing floor. You get credit for that. But they didn't do the work. How much of our lives is us enjoying the benefit of somebody else's work, somebody else's passion, somebody else's ability? Oh, you think, well, Pastor, I earn everything I have. How many of you guys bake your bread every day? Fresh, new. How many of you guys go out and slaughter your meat and grow your own crops and sew your own clothes? We are all, well, Pastor, I pay for those. Well, how would you be able to pay for that if customers didn't come in? And we forget so quickly how interconnected we are and dependent on one another. How if we were left in a bubble all by ourselves, we would surely die. There's a pride in saying, I've done it myself and I've pulled myself up and my name's on that check account and my name's on that title and my name's on that deed and golly, I've done it. Oh, friends, what a fool's errand that is for all of us. Instead, we should be reminded that pride is what brings us to the fall, and we realize that if not for the blessing of God and the help of others, we would not have anything. Friends, if we don't remember these things, that destruction comes through these different ways, and there's many other ways, but specifically we're talking about these ones today. If we don't seek the Lord for His protection in the midst of these destructions, ruin is where we're going to find ourselves. It was true of the folks back wandering around in the desert, and it's true of us wandering around this land trying to figure out what the meaning of life is. The meaning of life is to give everything we have submission to the Father so that we might approach His throne without fear. Because when Jesus is our protection, providing all the things that we need, we have no fear, and we can approach Him with the knowledge that He is in control, that He has borne the weight of our iniquity, and that He is providing for the needs that we have for His kingdom's sake and for the glory of His name. Let's pray about these things. Heavenly Father, I ask, Lord, that You would help us to know You more, to trust in You, to walk in Your ways, to look like Your Son, to be filled with Your Spirit, and to serve Your kingdom. Lord, there's so many ways that we can falter. There's so many ways that we can fall. Destruction comes through pride and plunder and perversion and poverty. And really, destruction comes when we're apart from You. Lord, help us to be in You, with You, by You, through You, for You, of You, that we would never leave, that we would never fall short, that we would always run to Your embrace. Lord, help us not to be so short-sighted that we forget that You are in charge. Let us have a mind and a heart for You. And may we share it with as many as would hear it. We ask these things in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen. Friends, as we close our time together, what I want to encourage each and every one of us here is to be mindful and remember that destruction is out there. And it comes through these ways that we've talked, but it all relates to the fact that when we're apart from Him, no success can come to us. May we be plugged into Him everywhere we go. If you want to talk more about this with me, please don't be shy about it. Just bring it up. Let's talk. Let's have these conversations so that we know that we are working towards those good works that God has prepared for us, this life of service and submission that He wants from us. I struggle with it just as much as you do, because pride and poverty and all those things are just as real for my life as they are for yours. But with His help and together as a church, we can walk in His ways. We can be shaped to look more like His Son. We can be filled with His Spirit so that we might serve Him, because that's what it's all about. Service to Him, worshiping as we go. Friends, let me invite you to stand as we close the time, and I'll pray a final prayer of blessing and hope for what God is doing. Love to see you here on Wednesday night starting at 6:30 for the Stations of the Cross. It should be a sweet and tender time for everyone. I hope that you can make it. Heavenly Father, I ask, Lord, that You would show us Your grace, You would show us Your mercy, that it would be made new fresh to us every day, so fresh that it just bubbles over and that we have no other recourse but to show it to others as well. Lord, may we speak the words of truth that give You glory and give You grace. Show Your grace to the people of this world, to the people that we love. I pray, Lord, that You would help us to live for You each day. It's in Your name we pray.